So we are all members of the Mediterranean shore, and it's a great pleasure. Now we just have to wait for some of the technical details. Apparently somebody is on the way to help us. So I don't know. We shall just wait for it.
Say a few words concerning what, how do you see this relationship, and what are your long experiences, how it was successful or not?
Okay, so just as this short time to say a few words. First, I need to stress that I am no philosopher, I'm a physicist, a theoretical physicist, but I have been interested in the philosophical issues since I was a young boy, young student. And so you have a connection which is more that of, let's say, an amateur concerning philosophy. So I would consider myself as a professional physicist and an amateur philosopher. The point is to, the important point to me is the fact that today it seems to me that in the modern times, let's say, for the second half of the 20th century, the connections between physics and philosophy have become too weak. Most physicists are not educated in philosophical issues, and conversely, which means that several big problems, several big issues concerning modern physics, either in relativity theory or in quantum mechanics, still are not solved, but not even discussed at a sufficient level. It is very striking to note that some of these deep problems concerning, for instance, the understanding of quantum mechanics have evolved very slowly along the 20th century. People thought that these problems were solved in the 30s, in the Copenhagen School and so on and so on. And so it was a rather big surprise for people of my generation to see these problems coming up again, let's say in the years 60s to 70s. And so I think that concerning the future of physics, it would be nice not to lose too much time as we have done in the 20th century. So conferences like this, to me, are very important, especially concerning young people, young students, in the hope to have them more and better prepared to face the difficult conceptual issues of science today. Now let me add just a single word, because Professor Sokolich has mentioned the review, the quarterly I am editing, which is called Alliage, which means alloy. And this is supposed to be an alloy not so much between physics and philosophy. As I said, I am not a professional philosopher, but more between science in general and culture in general. So the subtitle of this quarterly is Culture, Science, Technique, Culture, Science, Technology. And for now 25 years, we have been putting out this review, which tries to have people from either coming from science, physics, mathematics, chemistry, and so on, or from humanities, writers, or even musicians or painters working together. And I would be pleased to send some of you who would be interested in some leaflet or even some examples of the quarterly, which unfortunately is in French. Thank you. So,
talks to philosopher colleagues or even students. When I invite philosophers in my department of physics, that was much more difficult. So I think today the responsibility is much more in the side of scientists than in philosophers. I think that is my experience in France. Despite the fact that French people say they are very proud of this wrong experience of relationship between physics, between science and philosophy, but I think it's just they say that, but they don't do it most of the time.
And I have a question concerning the...
So we have to switch it off and start again. Yes, yes. I'm sorry, we have to solve these small details first.
Switch it on the... Maybe console or
whatever. Oh. That's why we couldn't open it for lightning.
Yeah, yeah, it really couldn't. Yes, this is a very nice photograph of lightning in full day. It was taken by sheer chance by one of my granddaughters. Now, let us still... Good. So that's it. All right, so I will speak today about the famous or infamous, I don't know, twin paradox. And the title is a twin paradox, re to the power n, because it has been discussed again and again for the past century. We have more than 100 years of experience discussing this paradox. And there are literally hundreds or even thousands of papers dealing with it. As I will try to show to you, it's not a logical paradox, it's true physics, it's experimentally confirmed, but still you have to understand what it means, and this is what I'm going to try to do for you. So this is one of the many, many cartoons, pictures illustrating the paradox, where you see a young Einstein who is traveling with a high speed, and old Einstein, who is welcoming him. Now, in a nutshell, the paradox is the following. Suppose you have two twins, same age, of course, because they are twins. One of them is going in a rocket towards a very far away star, and the other is waiting for him on Earth. So the traveling twin goes out, and after some time, he comes back. Time has been rather long, so it's the twin which has stayed on Earth is very aged. And when the other one comes out of his rocket, he's much younger than his brother. So this is in a nutshell the paradox. You have two twins, and one is aging more than the other. Let me start with a short history of the paradox, because it's rather interesting. In fact, the idea was realized right from the beginning of relativity theory. In fact, Einstein, in his famous 1905 paper, which is the stepping stone of relativity theory, says this: if one of two synchronous clocks at the point A is moved in a closed curve with constant velocity until it returns to A, then by the clock which has remained at rest, the current clock on its arrival at A will be late. So you have two clocks, one which is not moving, the other one which is moving around, and when they meet again, they don't show the same time. This was realized by Einstein in the first paper. It was not so much noticed at the time, just because it is a simple sentence in the paper. And there were so many new things in the paper that this point was overlooked by most people. Einstein again, later in 1911, in a review paper on relativity theory, living organisms, for his example. He says if one were to put a living organism in a box, and he is thinking obviously about bacteria or microbes, send it away for a long travel and then come back to the starting point, one could find it almost unchanged, the moving one, almost unchanged, while similar organism, stayed put, would have been since a long time replaced by further generations. For the mobile organism, the travel would have lasted but a short instant, provided the velocity would have been close to that of light. Third example, it's Langevin, and probably it's the most well-known example of this paradox. You see here a photograph of Langevin and Einstein, were very good friends, by the way. And Langevin, in the same year, 1911, in a very, very nice paper on the evolution of space and time, in which he shows a very deep understanding of relativity theory. In fact, Langevin was probably one of the first to understand in deep, with a deep understanding of relativity theory, perhaps even more than Einstein himself in some point. And he says, he puts forward a more spectacular example than clocks or microbes, because he says that this remark, the preceding remark he made, would enable one to know what the Earth will look like in 2 centuries from now, so you can travel into the future, and to explore its future in spending but 2 years of his own life. He could make a jump in time, which for him would last but 2 years, while it would be 2 centuries long for the Earth. But he would have to abandon any hope of return, so you cannot travel in the past. You can travel in the future, you cannot travel in the past, which removes most logical problems. To have any hope of return and could not inform us of the result of his travel, since any such attempt would only carry him forward. To this end, it would be sufficient that our traveler locks himself in a missile, which would be launched from the Earth with a velocity close enough to the speed of light, so that he would encounter a nearby star after 1 year, be sent back to Earth with the same velocity. If in between his velocity has remained close to that of light, say by a 20,000th, on his return, being himself older by 2 years, you would find our globe older by 2 centuries. The most solid established experimental facts of physics allow us to assert this. This is a very strong statement, because there were at that time no direct experimental evidence for this phenomenon, but Langevin was sufficiently confident that all the experimental evidence which was sustaining relativity theory would lead to that conclusion. And finally, von Laue, also a great exponent of relativity theory, says, he starts with 2 clocks and the same argument over and over again, and he says a form of life will return to its starting point younger than its initial contemporary. No twins up to now, and the twins enter with Weil, Hermann Weil, in a paper of 1918, the life of a man can very well be compared to a clock. Let 2 twins, that's the first mention of twins, let 2 twins part company, the first one staying at home, that is to say, not moving in its reference frame, the second one living with speeds relativity to his country, close to that of Earth. When he returns home, he's notably younger than his sedentary brother. So it is this statement, which is made with people, twins, which made a big fuss. Of course, as long as you are talking about clocks or microorganisms, this is not so much paradoxical after all, but if you invoke living people, aging people, that's something else, of course. And since that time, so you see, it's almost a century now, you have all this many, many comments. Now, one of the first to comment on the one of the first philosophers to comment on the twin paradox was Bergson. As you know, Bergson, in a book which is called Durée et Simultanéité in 1921, tried to think about the philosophical interpretation of relativity theory. And it was a very strong effort. He worked very hard trying to understand the very formalism of relativity theory, struggling with the equations themselves and so on. But he could not completely understand it. The book is very interesting still today, because on some points Bergson shows a very deep understanding of what's going on, but on other points, and especially on the twin paradox, he does not want to accept it. And his argument is the following. If one considers closely enough the Lorentz formulas are the formulas which connect the measurement of space and time made by one of the twins with the measurements made by the other one. And it's the Lorentz formula is really the essence of relativity theory. If one considers closely enough the Lorentz formulas, one realizes that 2 years of Paul, this is the moving twin, are only attributed to Paul by the physicist Pierre. Pierre is the one who stays on Earth. The Paul who lives in a slower time than Pierre's is a fantastical being. So for Bergson, this is just an illusion. If Pierre is looking at Paul, he believes that Paul ages less, but according to Bergson, when they meet again, they will still be the same age. But that is not true. Bergson was wrong on that count. And as Einstein said in a letter to his friend Solovey in 1923, Bergson, in his book on relativity theory, has made monstrous blunders. God will forgive him. And even Einstein forgave him, because they were a very close friend. They met for the first time in 1921 in a famous visit which Einstein made in France, but they could not really understand each other. It was not a real dialogue, but afterwards they become rather friendly with one another, especially working together in the Society of Nations, in the Intellectual Committee. And so Einstein forgave Bergson. And Bergson, in fact, was very puzzled by the twin paradox, so much so that he asked for his book, Durée et Simultanéité, no longer to be printed. For quite a number of decades, the book was out of print, and people could not read him. And most physicists thought, well, that's just nonsense. Bergson has not understood a single point about relativity theory, which is not true. The book is worthwhile reading, and Bergson makes some very interesting and deep remarks, but he also makes some blunders, especially that one, not accepting the paradox. I think the case of Dingle as the last example of the reaction. Herbert Dingle, 1890 to 1976, was a British physicist and astronomer, rather famous, good astronomer, who made quite a number of contributions, but could never accept relativity theory. And up to the end of his life, is up to the years 1970s, he fought very hard against relativity theory, saying things like that in a book dated 72. Some years ago, I gave, as the culmination of several similar efforts, a simple proof that the special relativity theory was untenable. In an article in Nature, I claimed that the twins must necessarily age at the same rate because it was an essential requirement of the special theory of relativity, which I then believed to be sound, that no observation was possible that would enable one to ascribe the motion preferentially to either twin. The argument in a nutshell, I will come back to it later on, is if we believe in the relativity of motion, then who is the moving twin and who is the immobile twin, we cannot know, and so there cannot be a difference between them. This is a wrong argument, I will show you. But Dingle fought for quite a time against relativity theory, including a time, 1972, this is a period where high energy physics is highly developed and no accelerator would work if relativity theory was wrong. Big accelerators of particles, like the one in CERN and many others in the United States and elsewhere, rely very specifically on relativity theory. Okay, so that was a short history of the paradox. Now let me give a brief theoretical sketch of what is going on. I will avoid as far as possible to use too many equations for those of you who are not physicists, but there will be a few formal expressions. So short reminder about relativities, and I underline the plural, you will see why in a few minutes. We start from Galileo, who in his famous book on two new sciences, which is the founding book of modern mechanics, says something like motion is as nothing, which means, in fact, in modern terms, you have to be more precise and to say uniform motion, that is motion with constant velocity, is like nothing, which means that there is no absolute distinction, contrary to the old Aristotelian point of view, between rest and motion. The point is, if you are going with constant velocity, you cannot distinguish what's going on for you from what would be going on if you would be at rest. And this, of course, the experience we all had when you are in a train and the train on the side you is starting, you don't know for a time which one is moving. So this is the deepest assertion concerning the relativity of motion. Let me stress the relativity of uniform motion. That's very important. In more modern and more technical terms, physicists today would say the laws of physics are the same when expressed in two reference frames in uniform relative motion. That is, if you are doing physics in a railway station, or if you are doing physics in a moving train, provided it has a constant velocity, use exactly the same laws of physics. There is no difference between them. This is the principle of relativity, and no difference between uniform relative motions, including rest. Now, this is not sufficient to do physics. This is a principle, but you have to use this principle in more concrete terms to have a theory of relativity. A theory of relativity will tell you, beyond this general principle, how you connect the physical measurements in these two equivalent reference frames, the railway station and the train. Of course, people in the train and people in the station do not make the same observation. The measurements they make of time, of space, of speeds are different. What is the same is the laws of physics, that is the relationships between these magnitudes. But the quantities themselves, the measured quantities, are not the same. So you have to know to use this principle, which is too much abstract to be used, you have to know how to make it concrete. That is, you must know how to relate the physical magnitude in the two frames. And this is what we call a theory of relativity, which is a concrete, specific expression of the principle of relativity. Why the plural here or here? Just because we have at least two theories of relativity. The first one is the one of Galileo, or Galileo, Newton, and so on and so on. Classical physics, classical mechanics is a relativity theory. There is a way to tell you, according to formula of mechanics for four centuries old now, how to connect the measurements in the railway station and in the train. Of course, this theory was not explicited, but it was implicit in the working of old mechanics. And it became explicit only when it was discovered to be wrong by Einstein and other people at the time, which means that we have now a new modern Einsteinian theory of relativity. But as long as you do not relate our modern theory to the old classical one, you do not understand really what is going on. So Einstein, in a sense, that must be emphasized, did not invent relativity theory. He invented the new relativity theory. That is, he modified the old relativity theory to take into account new physical phenomena which were discovered in the 19th century. For instance, the constancy of the velocity of light and things of that sort. All right, so to be a bit more precise now, let's go to the idea of the twins. We take two twins. The first one I call Seb because he's sedentary. He stays on Earth, while his sister twin, Tracy, you see I'm politically correct, there's a boy and a girl, so that's okay. Tracy, who is a traveler, leaves for the star Alpha Centauri with constant velocity V, and she returns with the same velocity. So we draw a time-space diagram, as usual. This is the measurement of space, distance from the Earth. This is the time axis seen by Seb. And you see that this is the motion of Tracy. She starts with the velocity V. In the time T1, she covers a distance VT1, of course. This is Alpha Centauri, which is at this distance. And then she turns back, and with the same velocity, but in the other direction, she comes back to meet her brother, Seb, at O prime. This takes her time T2. Now, for Seb, the duration of Tracy's travel is T1 plus T2, and the point, the deep point about relativity theory is the fact that the time T1, big T1 taken by Tracy to for the first part of her travel is not the same as small T1, and it's same argument for T2. For Tracy, you have big T, which is T1 plus T2, and it turns out, this I will not go into the technical details, which comes from these famous Lorentz formulas. It is a fact, according to relativity theory, that the small t and big t's, that is Seb times and Tracy's times, are not identical, they're related by a factor gamma, and this factor gamma is just 1 over the square root of 1 minus v squared over c squared. Never mind the exact expression, the point is that this factor is always bigger than 1, larger than 1, which means that small t1 is larger than big t, small t2 is larger than big t2, and then small t, the total time for Seb, is larger than the total time t for Tracy. Okay, so that is the paradox. One of the twin, Tracy, makes her travel in a shorter time than the time needed by Seb to wait for her. And so that when they meet again, Seb is older than Tracy. Of course, this is the very shocking statement, which is very difficult to accept and to understand. So there were a lot of objections and sidesteps to try to eliminate this seemingly contradictory statement. The first objection was, well, you are talking about twins, that is biological organism, but you have no guarantee that biological time is the same as physical time. So you could find a lot of papers and articles, the content of which is, we cannot be sure that aging as a biological process follows the laws of physics, and especially the theory of relativity. So these people were more or less ready to accept it for clocks, let's say, or for mechanical devices, but not for living organisms or people. But this is very hard to follow as an argument, because we are even less sure that it does not follow the laws of physics. And modern biology gives us any reason to think that biological time has to be consistent with physical time. You cannot reduce it to physical time, but at least it has to be consistent with it. It's true that your psychological time is not identical to the physical time, but the biological time you are living is at root a chemical, hence physical time, something which is happening in your cells, organism, and so on and so on. So this objection, this is why I call it objection number zero, it cannot really be convincing, especially since even if you accept it, you are left with the paradox for clocks or mechanical devices. The paradox, also less striking, holds as well for clocks and other timekeeping devices, as you will see here. Now, objection one, that's the most important objection, which was made again and again. It is the objection of Dingle and many others. It's the alleged reciprocity between the two twins. It goes as follows. Theory of relativity is based on the equivalence of reference frames. Then, by considering the situation from Tracy's point of view in her rocket, she's at rest in her rocket. And for her, it is Seb who is going out and coming back. So for her, Seb is leaving and returning. And what should then conclude that Seb is younger than Tracy? So you would have two contradictory statements which cannot be true together, which would ruin the paradox. Now, this argument is wrong for the following reason. This would imply logical contradiction. Now, the point is the following. The theory of relativity asserts the equivalence of reference frames in uniform relative motion. That is, with constant relative velocity. But Tracy's rocket does not have such a uniform motion with respect to Earth, since it turns back, which implies observable physical effects, that is acceleration. When Tracy arrives near Alpha Centauri, her rocket is slowing down, so there is an acceleration, and her baggage is falling down. There are all sorts of other effects, which you know very well when you are in a train or in a car. So let us suppose, for instance, that at the beginning you put Seb in a rocket, Tracy in another rocket, side to side, and you tell them one of you is going to travel while the other one is staying at rest. Imagine the rockets are completely closed, no windows, nothing you can see outside. Yet, Seb can know that he's not moving, and Tracy can know she is moving, because she will experience physically accelerations, while Seb will not be accelerated, so he will be able to conclude, I am at rest, and Tracy is able to say, I am the one who is traveling, I am accelerating to start, braking and accelerating backwards. So there is no symmetry between them. There is an objective difference between Tracy and Seb, which explains that there is no logical contradiction in the paradox. It is perhaps difficult to accept and to understand, but at least it is not a logical contradiction. It is not a paradox in the sense of a logical difficulty. Objection number two. This is Bergson's Bergson's objection. And I'm quoting Bergson. By considering closely the Lorentz formulas, one sees that Tracy's years are but years attributed to Tracy by Sam. Same argument I showed earlier. The Tracy who lives in a time slower than Seb's is a fantasmatical being. She's the vision of Seb when he conforms to the perspective rules which are given by the Lorentz formulas. Seb and Tracy can be compared to two persons of normal size who see one another as shrunk by the distance. Each one is degraded as a dwarf in the representation of the other. Nobody will conclude that either one is effectively dwarfed. The dwarf is a fantasy. Only the person with normal size is real. So Bergson says, just an illusion. Seb thinks that Tracy's time is slower, but they will, when they will meet again, it's like a perspective effect, but the person comes back, you see that it has a normal size. This argument is wrong. This argument is wrong because contrary to what Bergson says here, the years of Tracy are indeed Tracy's years, measured in her rocket with her own clocks. They are not years attributed, not at all, contrary to what Bergson said, they are not years attributed by Seb to Tracy. Tracy has her own watch, and on her watch, on her clock, she's aging by 2 years, while Seb is aging by 2 centuries by his own clocks. So indeed, Bergson was wrong. The Lorentz formulas are not rules of perspective. They express, in fact, parallax effect in space and time. Let me just be a bit more explicit. So here you see a perspective effect. Large people near and small people far away. And of course, if you if these people come back, you will see they are normal size. But this is not at all what the twin effect is. The twin effect is not a perspective effect, contrary to what Bergson says. It is a parallax effect. What do I mean by a parallax effect? Just the following. Take ordinary Euclidean space, our space, and take a small segment of length L. If you measure it along an axis which is not its axis, of course you will see a shorter distance. For instance, if I have a rule here and I want to measure the length of this thing, if I put it obliquely with respect to the rule, of course I will not get the true length of the object. In order to measure the true length of the object, I have to have it exactly along the rule I used to measure it. It's obvious. And it's obvious to us, because we know standard Euclidean geometry, that if you do not do that, if you measure it from that, well, you have a projection effect, a cosine, which makes the apparent length smaller than real length, and we are not surprised by this fact. And so this is parallax because we do not have the same axis, we measure the length along the wrong axis. But you know how to correct it, just a cosine. Geometry tells you how to make the correction. You have exactly the same thing in Minkowski space, that is in space and time space, which is the fact that if somebody is traveling along this space-time axis, the length of its travel, if you measure it along his own axis, is not the same as the length measured along this axis and the same for the duration. Now it's a bit more complicated because the Lorentz formulas are not the same as the formulas of Euclidean geometry, but the nature of the effect is exactly the same. If you want to measure the real duration of a phenomenon, you have to measure it with clocks which are associated to the phenomenon, who goes with it. If you measure the length, the duration of the phenomenon with clocks which are moving with respect to the phenomenon, you don't get the same duration, exactly as it is the case with ordinary space here. So I think the best way to speak about these effects, which are the so-called, that's a bad wording, dilatation of time, contraction of length, dilation of time, it should be much better to speak about parallax effect. In fact, time is not dilated, lengths are not contracted. They look contracted, or they look dilated, exactly as I showed you on this geometrical example. Now, these objections do not hold. Now, there are other ways to try to refuse or reject the apparent paradox, which is to sidestep it. First trial to sidestep it is to invoke general relativity. The argument goes like that. Special relativity only applies to uniform motions. Since Rice's motion is not uniform, one cannot use special relativity and must resort to general relativity. So that's a way just to put the dirt under the rug and to say we cannot solve the problem with special relativity, we put it outside and let other people try to solve it. But this argument does not hold either, it's a confusion. Because relativity, whether Galilean or Einsteinian, requires uniform motion as the criterion of equivalence between two reference frames. That's true. But it does not prevent us to study accelerated motion in such frames. That's already true in the most ordinary classical mechanics. Since the time of Galileo, we know how to measure, how to deal with free fall, which is an accelerated motion. So we can very well treat accelerated motion in terms of relativity, whether Galilean or Einsteinian. There is no need at all to go towards general relativity. So trivial example is free fall in classical mechanics. And in fact, general relativity, this is again a bad name, a misnomer. General relativity, in fact, is a theory of gravitation. As long as you do not deal with gravitational effects, you don't need it. And in the examples I gave with Seb and Tracy, there is no gravity intervening, so you do not have to use general relativity, you have to use only special relativity. So you cannot avoid the paradox by going to general relativity. Second way to study, try to sidestep the paradox. What about the accelerations? Tracy's motion, in fact, is not uniform. She experiences, as I said, this is what is breaking the symmetry. She experiences acceleration, infinite ones as well, because she's starting from rest, and suddenly she goes with velocity v. And when she turns back, she goes suddenly from velocity v to velocity minus v, which is again an infinite acceleration. So she's experiencing accelerations. Any clock will be disturbed or even disrupted by these dynamical accelerations, and its measurements have no reason to coincide with the prediction of a purely kinematical theory of relativity. That is an argument against the effect. This argument has to be considered at face value. However, it only points out to the simplistic character of modeling the back and forth travel with constant velocity. More realistic models are easily built with a continuously varying velocity and limited acceleration, as small as you want, without changing the result. I will show you, this to you in a few minutes. Now, what does the experience tell us today? First, I want to stress, as Langevin did one century ago, it is to be forcefully stressed that the conceptual consistency and experimental validity of Einsteinian relativity in general already offers an indirect but excellent evidence for the twin effect. What I mean by that is the following. When I take a theorem of Euclidean geometry, that is, the sum of the angles of a triangle is 180 degrees. you don't need to make again and again measurements on millions of triangles to verify this statement. This statement derives from the axioms of Euclidean geometry, and experimental evidence is not required for you to trust what's going on with concrete triangles. So you have the same thing here. If special relativity is correct, as we believe from many, many experimental results, including, for instance, the very fact that particle accelerators I was alluding to before are working quite well, and this cost $1 billion. So you could say that relativity theory is verified on a scale which is billions of dollars, then relativity theory, you can trust it with all its consequences, including the twin effect. Now, can we try to verify the effect directly with real twins? These guys are true twins. Scott and Mark Kelly, they're true twins, and both are astronauts of the NASA. And they have a different history of traveling in space. In fact, Mark has spent 50 days and Scott 180 orbiting the Earth in the International Space Station with an average velocity of 28,000 kilometers per hour. So if the twin effect is correct, they should not be the same age. So you do the calculation, and what happens is that this velocity, which looks very high, is in fact very small compared to the velocity of light, which is the standard we have to use here. And when you do the calculation, they indeed have accumulated the difference of aging of a few milliseconds. But few milliseconds is much less than the age difference at birth, because they were not born in the same millisecond. There were several minutes at least separating them. So this means that on the scale of real people with present day technology, you cannot check the effect. Yet you can check it with other physical devices. Muons, these are high energy particles which are unstable. And an experiment was made a long time ago, already in 77, which shows the following. This is a sketch which shows you muons going around in an accelerator of particles. These are space coordinates. This is the time. So they are turning around and around in space while moving forward in time. So this is the trajectory in space-time. Sorry, what's happening? So you see that these muons keep turning around, so they come back to their starting point, and they turn with a very high velocity. And their velocity is so high, very high. They have an average lifetime of the order of 1 microsecond when they decay at rest. Microsecond is very small, but it's quite easy for physicists to measure it. And when they are kept in a storage ring, where they move with velocity which is 0.9994c, which is very near the velocity of light c, they exhibit a lifetime of several milliseconds, which means that the famous factor I showed you before is 3,000. So their lifetime is multiplied by 3,000. It's not a small effect. It's a very large effect, which is measured, which is verified, and this is indeed what is going on. And you have to note that in this experiment, the muons, since they are going around, they sustain a very high centripetal acceleration, which is huge. It's 10 to the 19 meter second square, which is 10 to the 18 the acceleration of gravity on Earth. So this means indeed that acceleration will not disturb the reality and estimates of the twin paradox. So that first experiment, which is quite conclusive. There is another one, more direct even, which was done a long time ago in 72, with real clocks moving in real planes. Hafele and Kitty were two physicists. What they did was to take atomic clocks, which were sufficiently precise already by that time, 40 years ago, and they flew their clocks on commercial airlines for a double world tour, one going eastwards, the other going westwards, and compared when coming back at their starting point, they compared with reference clocks held on the ground. You see, you have three types of clocks. No one is at rest here, because the one which is on Earth is turning with the Earth. The other one is turning fast. One is turning faster, the other is turning slower. And according to relativity theory, you should have here a paradox triplets, not twins, and you should have different readings on your three types of clock. Clock going westwards move faster than the gravity ones, must be late. The eastwards clock moves slower and should be in advance. But then, here you have a small complication. The flying clocks experience a change in altitude. Because of course the airplane flew in a few kilometers. And then there is a change in the gravitational potential. And then you have to invoke also general relativity. You have a supplementary effect. So it's a bit more complicated to make the theory for this experience. Now, the results are the following. You see here the theoretical predictions. If you take only the special relativity effect, you should have a retardation effect of the eastwards clock by roughly 200 nanoseconds, which is quite small, but quite measurable with atomic clocks, and a gravity effect, which is a bit more over 100. Westwards, it's the other sign, while the gravity effect, of course, is the same sign, because it's just plane going up. So when you do the total sum of relativity plus gravity effect, this is what you get, and this is the experimental results. You see that there is a rather large experimental uncertainty, but yet the experimental results are in rather good agreement with the theoretical ones. And you check simultaneously the special relativity effect and the general relativity effect. This experiment was repeated in 1996, then in 2010, with much improved atomic clocks, and we have today a much improved precision on these measurements, though there is absolutely no longer any doubt about the effect. So much so that this effect is nowadays incorporated in the GPS localization devices, because when you are located with the GPS device, it's rather high in the sky, different potential, gravitational potential, high velocity, and if you want to be sufficiently precise and to measure your position within a few meters, which is what present-day GPS does, you have to take into account this effect. Well, the fact that the GPS of your car is working correctly is a proof of the reality of this effect. Now, it is interesting to allude to a few other possible scenarios than the usual twin. Why? Because the usual scenario, the one which I showed you, the Seb staying at rest and Tracy going and coming back, suffers from three oversimplifications. One of the twins is at rest, so that's not very general. The other travels with a constant velocity, which is not general also. And he undergoes infinite acceleration when departing, turning back, and arriving. More general scenarios, I will show you two of them, may help to a better understanding and an easier acceptance. In fact, if you take a more general point of view, you will not have such counter arguments as the one concerning acceleration and so on and so on. For instance, you could do a case with continuous acceleration. That is, Tracy leaves with a constant acceleration. She is indeed at rest. She starts with a very small velocity, but a constant acceleration, and her velocity goes increasing more and more. And when she's decelerating, she does the same. She uses a constant acceleration, deceleration to turn back. And when she arrives home, again, she decelerates very progressively, which means that her trajectory in space and time looks like that. Instead of having the straight lines I showed you before, she's starting very slowly, then accelerating, then braking, stopping, going backwards very slowly, more rapidly, then braking and arriving with a small velocity. You can do the calculation, I will not do it here. Let me just show the equation for the people who are interested in it. The velocity is changing with time, like a hyperbolic tangent. That's a simple exercise in relativity theory, very simple. If you do the calculation, what is the duration of the travel for Tracy in her proper time, the first phase, you have to do some integration, you get a complicated expression, never mind. The point is that the ratio between T1, that is the time she takes from here to here, and the times from here to here, is smaller than 1. For the 4 phases of the travel, you see it's quite symmetrical, you have the same. And for the complete journey, once again, the time taken by Tracy compared to the time taken by Sam is smaller than 1. The point is that if the acceleration and time are much smaller than 1, you recover the result of usual standard Galilean mechanics, so the times are roughly the same. But now if the product of gamma and tau is much larger than 1, which means that around here, Tracy is reaching a velocity close to that of light. Gamma tau is her maximum velocity. Then, according to this horrible expression, the time taken by the traveling twin, TV, is much smaller than the time taken by T, even, that's an important point, even if the acceleration itself is very small. So if you do this experiment with a very small acceleration, but if you wait sufficiently long, very small acceleration, but very long time, you will get the usual result, and indeed the edges will not be the same. The acceleration as such has nothing to do with the phenomenon. Could do it with a very, very small acceleration. Now let me sketch another scenario just for fun. It's a fable, the Hare, the Tortoise, and Einstein. For those who are interested, I have put forward a short paper on archive recently. So this is Einstein puzzled by the Hare and the Tortoise fable. It goes as follows. So this is the tortoise. She's starting at once from the beginning of the race with the velocity V. The hare takes a nap for a period delta, and then she sees that the tortoise is rather far away, and she starts running with the velocity V prime, which is larger than the tortoise, but unfortunately, she starts too late, and she arrives at the finishing line with the fox, as in the original fable, it's the fox which measures the arrival times. The hare arrives too late, and the tortoise has won the race. That's the usual way to put it. But, and so this is what the calculation you would do with ordinary mechanics. The time taken by the fox is tau, I put delta, but this should be tau, sorry. Tau plus d, the distance run over the velocity v prime, minus d over v, which is the tortoise time. But if you take the difference between the proper times, that is the times measured by the hare itself on its own clock and the tortoise itself by its own clock, you have to include these factors, always the same, to correct this assumption. So the difference between the proper times both measures on their own clocks is a bit different. And now it happens, you can check it with these formulas, that you can have simultaneously delta larger than zero and delta prime smaller than zero, which means that when the fox measures the times, he sees indeed the hare which arrives first and then the fox. So he says to the fox, you have lost the race. And the fox says, no, I have not, because look at my watch. I have done the race in 15 minutes, which is less than the time taken by the tortoise. So this is an illustration of the paradox, but it's a bit different. It's more general, and in a sense, it's more illustrative, because you see that you compare different trajectories in space-time. You have no, you don't have the privilege of one staying at rest. Both experimenters are traveling. So the hare arrives after the tortoise, indeed, but its journey has been shorter to him. I sketch just very briefly a third scenario before coming to my conclusion and last comments. The following, it's a story, science fiction story. The starship Argo is to depart for the faraway planet Colchis. Among its crew, twin brothers, Castor and Pollux, as navigation officers. Unfortunately, at last moment, Castor falls victim to a strange disease and cannot board. Left alone on Earth, he laments about his fate, all the more so since he knows that on returning, his twin Pollux will be much younger than him, thus breaking the symmetry between their lifespans. Now, what happens is that sometime after the departure of the expedition, the engineers discovered that a flaw in the design of the ship threatens its safe return. It is then decided to launch an urgent rescue expedition. A second starship named Urgo is to join the Argo on its way and help its crew. Of course, Castor asked for being part of the second expedition and is chosen to lead it. It then decides to plan the trip so as to meet his twin Pollux at a time where they will have reached the same age and can still celebrate a common anniversary. Is this possible at all? The space-time diagram is that. This is the trip planned by for Pollux in the spaceship Argo, so it's the same as for Tracy's beyond, before. He goes out and he comes back and they should meet at that point at that time. But Castor, in fact, at time T0, leaves to join Castor. Of course, he needs to have a larger velocity, V prime, than Argo to in order to reach him. And now you have to do the calculation. It's again an exercise in relativity theory. Is it possible that the proper time of Pollux between his departure and his meeting with his brother is the same as the time taken by Castor on the when staying at Earth and then making travel on Argo? The answer is yes. They can have the same age, they can celebrate a common anniversary, provided Castor leaves the Earth soon enough. That is, never mind the formulas, I leave it to you as a homework exercise for tonight. And now I will conclude with more general comment, which is the following. I will we'll try to convince you that instead of speaking about relativity, it should be much better to speak about chronogeometry. The idea is the following. Geometry, as we know it, Euclidean geometry, that is just the theory of space structure. It tells you how space around us is organized, how space has properties such as, sum of the angles of a triangle is 180 degrees, and so on and so on. This is what we call geometry, the theory of the structure of space. What we call relativity, in fact, the theory of space-time structure. And it has the same relationship with space-time as ordinary geometry with space. So it should be much better to call it chronogeometry. Time, chrono, space, geometry, measurement. And in fact, the formal theory of special relativity is quite similar to the formal theory of Euclidean geometry. The only difference is that we deal with a four-dimensional space, space and time, instead of dealing with a three-dimensional space. But the analogy is very strong. It's even almost an homology. And if you take this chronogeometrical point of view, you can say the following. This is ordinary space, two-dimensional space. Now, in usual geometry, nobody is surprised by the fact that distance, geometrical distance, between two points A and B depends on the path from one to the other. If you go from A to B like this, or if you go from A to B like this, it's obvious to us that the length of the trajectory is not the same. And we know that among all the possible paths, there is a shortest distance corresponding to the path in straight line. This is usual, what we know, what we believe in, what we are very used to think. Now, look at space-time now. One dimension of space, for simplifying reasons, and one dimension of time. I take two events, A and B, two points in space-time. That is something which happens here in space and at that time. This happens here in space and at that time. In chronogeometry, that is dealing with space-time, the time duration separating A and B between these two events depends on the world line joining them. Depending on whether you join A, event A to event B, going like that or going like that, you will not have the same duration of this travel. And there is a longest proper time corresponding to the world line with constant velocity, which is inertial motion, or technical terms, space-side geodesics, which gives a maximal time. So in space, in pure space, you have the minimal distance. In space and time, you have a maximal duration, which means that indeed there is a difference. Not this chronogeometry is not exactly like ordinary geometry. But as far as the principle is concerned, we should not be more surprised by the fact that the duration depends on the way we join A to B than we are when we deal with ordinary space. So if you take this chronogeometrical point of view, the analogy with geometrical, pure geometrical argument is such that there is no longer something paradoxical. If there is something paradoxical now, it's rather in the classical view of time, Newtonian time, which tells you that there is a universal time which is the same independently of the trajectory you follow. This is in fact what is paradoxical and what we should understand. We do understand it as an approximation of the structure, of the real Einstein structure of space and time. I may just say a few words. In Euclidean geometry, the distance between two points is given by the famous Pythagoras theorem. The length of the hypotenuse squared is just delta x squared plus delta y squared. This is what we physicists call a spatial metric, because it gives us the way to measure space. Now, in space-time, you have something very similar. If you take a space-time interval, which corresponds to a space interval and a time interval, you still have, in Einstein chronogeometry, an expression, a pseudo-distance between two events, which is given by a formula which is quite similar to the Pythagoras theorem, except that you have a minus sign. And this minus sign here makes the qualitative difference, the conceptual difference, between time and space. Time is not a fourth dimension as the three dimensions of space. It's a dimension of another kind. So there is a difference between space and time, but you can't make them together in chronogeometry. This is true for any initial frame. I go very fast here, because this is a bit too technical. And I will end with what I think is a clarifying analogy. It is often said that traces motion, this is what Bergson says, for instance, a trace's motion makes her time running slower, or that it slows down her clock compared to Sam. This is a very usual expression. In many textbooks or popularization text, you will see sentences to that effect. Motion makes it so that the clocks are slowing down. Time is slower when you are moving. This is a very bad way of putting things. Why? Because it's a confusion. In fact, this is not true. Tracy's seconds go by and are measured by her clock exactly as for Sam. But there are less seconds for Tracy than there are for Sam. But her seconds are exactly the same as Sam's seconds. Analogy, in ordinary space, when you go from A to B, why is the straight line from A to B shorter than the curved line from A to B? It's not that lengths are larger or meters are larger on this curved line, just that you have more of them. If you take a ruler, it is the same ruler you will use along this path or along this one, but you will have more meters between A and B than you have around here. So it's exactly the same in space-time. You have the same durations of any second, whether for Tracy or whether for Seb. Both clocks, Tracy's one and Seb's one, run exactly in the same way. They run correctly. Their seconds are the same, but there are less seconds for Tracy than there are. As a conclusion, I will offer you the following. The twin paradox, you can still keep the name paradox if you understand it in the etymological sense of the word, that is paradoxa, against para intuitive notions and common opinion. It's not a logical contradiction, it is something which is indeed shocking for our common intuitions, all right? But then, is this not the case for any genuine scientific idea? Any genuine scientific idea goes against our intuitive notions and common opinion. The fact that the Earth is supposed to go around the Sun is counterintuitive, and this is just the reason why we need science. If this were not the case, what would be the necessity and interest of science itself? If we need science, it is just because we need going against intuitive notions and common opinion. This is what the French philosopher of science, Bachelard stressed over and over again in what he called la philosophie du non, to the effect that science is saying no to what we usually believe, and this is what makes it interesting. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the nice talk. We have time for questions. Are there some?
And as I perceive the logical problem here, but it was, of course, from the physical point of view, solved by general relativity and all these solutions you sketched. But from the logical point of view, the problem, how all can be at the same in the united, again, united reference frame when they meet again. How can be either older or younger than yet? Because this should do, if you have, if there is a reciprocity, it can be so. Just for a moment, and maybe I'm, this question is rather complicated, but so for example, in Gödel, in Gödel, close time like loops, that's the main problem is when Paul or Pierre, if he travels in time, in the close time like loop, when he comes back to the main ship, he comes following the Einsteinian equations, he comes before he went to his trip. And here is, to my mind, the main problem, does he come in the same universe or in another universe, if we put into play the multiverse hypothesis? Because if he comes back in the same universe, then that's the problem with so-called grandfather paradox and so on. So that's only one of the questions. How do you, is it this solution you propose? Does it include this time-like, close time-like groups going into the past?
Not at all. Not at all. What I told you is the so-called twin paradox as seen by the usually called special relativity, which I prefer to call chronogeometry. In that theory and practice, as I showed you, experimental results are absolutely convincing. The reciprocity you mentioned does not exist. There is no reciprocity between Pierre and Paul. As I told you, even if they are enclosed in one another rocket, they know each one if he is moving or if she is not. So there is no reciprocity, so the paradox falls down at that level. Now, what you mentioned is something completely different. You put the problem at the level of general relativity, and indeed, in this so-called Gödel's universe, you have these closed loops in time. This is really paradoxical, I agree with you. Because there you have a logical problem, of course, if you can go back in time. In special relativity, you can never go back in time. You can travel in time in the future, all right, but this implies no logical paradox. If you find yourself after your 2 years in your ship, you come back to Earth and 2 centuries, the Earth will be 2 centuries older, that's a bit annoying for you because all your relatives are dead and so on and so on. There is absolutely no logical problem. You cannot kill your grandfather and so on and so on. So I state at that level, general relativity, which implies gravitational effects, is much more complicated. And indeed, the question you ask, to my mind, is not solved today. Whether it is possible to have these closed loops or whether you have some additional physical effects which prevents such universe to exist, there are very different opinions on that part, so I have no answer. But this is a very different question.
Sorry, just a little sub-question. I asked this because you mentioned, I quote, that the acceleration as such has nothing to do with this phenomenon of twin paradox. But this situation in Gödel's time-like use, it's an early acceleration there.
Yes, no, but all right. But it's acceleration in a curved space-time. Here we have a flat space-time. Chronogeometry operates in a flat space-time. If you go to a curved space-time, all sorts of very wild things can happen. So it's something else. It's really outside of the scope of what I call.
Thank you.
posed very clearly along the way, which was the idea that indeed the notion of the twin, we're using a reference to the human body as a clock. So the question, of course, is you're talking about chronogeometry, you're actually taking a notion of time as if it were predefined, where you haven't actually defined a clock for us. This is a key point because, indeed, as you noted, Einstein from 1905 had already identified what we'd call time dilation. In 1907, he said, well, we can actually consider the oscillation of an atomic ion to be a clock, right? And if so, then we have a possible physical manifestation of this time dilation effect in proton velocity measurements that were then being done by Stark. And so we have already have a first perhaps step towards actual physical manifestation of time dilations identified by Einstein himself. But here it doesn't seem like you're concentrating on just what a clock is. It seems like it's crucial to this case of the twin paradox because we're essentially the problem probably wouldn't exist, or at least for Bergson he wouldn't have had this difficulty if he had accepted the idea that indeed oscillations of atomic ions are clocks. But this is a definition that we're making of what time is it not?
Well, if you want to define time as a physicist, the point is that you have different clocks, and you make the implicit assumptions that in some way or another they run the same way. That's the deep assumption. Because if you, as you know, today the second is defined according to atomic clocks, and astronomical time as defined by the rotation of the Earth is not identical. By the way, we just added 1 second more to our days 2 days ago. 2 days ago, the day was 84,001 seconds, just to keep both times going together. So the assumption which may be questioned is up to what point our different clocks, whether mechanical, or atomic or biological, go with the same rate. I agree with you that this is an assumption, but an assumption of degree zero, in fact. If you don't make the assumption, you cannot tell anything. You just have to stop there. So you have to suppose that until it breaks down. But up to now, it has not. So we have no reason to think that biological clocks, I'm not thinking about psychological clocks, that's something completely different. But we have no reason to think that biological clocks are running on a completely different time as the chemical and physical clocks. So, unless you do the experiments with full twins and you find that something happens.
Thank you, Professor Lévy-Leblond, for this enlightening talk. I have more of a remark than a question. So you say that Bergson could not understand Einstein, and even though they were good friends, they couldn't even communicate to each other, Bergson being a philosopher, Einstein being a scientific. I would like to compare these two situations with Einstein with respect to Bohr. They were both physicists, and yet Einstein could not understand Bohr and quantum mechanics, even though quantum mechanics has been proven right today. So I think it's an interesting parallel of the same invariant Einstein with respect to two different people.
Do you want to comment or not?
Well, thank you. That's a very interesting question. I don't think that really the situations are the same. That is dialogue Einstein-Bergson, to my mind, is a different nature from the dialogue between Einstein and Bohr, for the following reason. What Bergson tried to say to Einstein, despite the fact that he did not understand the argument about twins. His main point was not so much about that. His main point was about what he was concerned with, that is, human time as we live it. It was living time. And on that point, I think Bergson was right. That is, the way we live in time, the way we feel time, the way we experiment duration is not exhausted by physics. Mechanical time, whether Newtonian one or Einsteinian one, it's just some kind of a skeleton of time which tells you your clock is working, but it doesn't tell you how you are feeling, whether you are finding that you are just bored and one hour is very long to you or very short. So I think that was the main point Bergson tried to explain to Einstein, and I think he was right on that point, trying to tell physicists that they don't say all that there is to say about time. Physicists have a certain notion of time, which is both very useful and very correct within the limits of physics, but it does not exhaust, not at all, the problem we have with feeling and understanding time. I think Bergson was quite right about that point, which is stressed also by putting forward the fact that we physicists, when we draw diagrams as the one I showed you, the ones I showed you, in a sense, we specialize time. We make it so that we draw an axis of time as if it was an axis of space. And in doing so, we are prone ourselves, physicists, to make quite a number of confusion. That again was a very good argument by Bergson. Do not forget that when you draw an axis of time, you are drawing it on a space. So in some sense, you are not, it's not a faithful representation of what we, of what you want to represent. There are a lot of very interesting arguments in Bergson's book, despite his blunders. Now, between Bohr and Einstein, I think the situation is a bit different. I think they understood each other, but they did not agree, which is something else. Einstein did not believe that the view Bohr had of physics was right. He believed that physics had to be, if we wanted to trust science and physics in particular, he wanted it to be deterministic, for instance. And Bohr was ready to abandon determinism and say, well, I can do physics in another way. So it was a disagreement rather than a misunderstanding. And the point is that seen from the present perspective, in some sense, they were both, what should I say, not wrong, but they were both, they both had a limited understanding of what was going on, which was normal in a sense. Quantum mechanics was very young. It was 10 or 20 years young. And it was not understood as it should be or starts to be today. Bohr was not aware of the modern arguments, the Aspe theorem, the Bell's theorem, Aspe experiment, and so on and so on, and all the arguments about intertwining and entanglement and so on and so on. So even Bohr has a very limited view of quantum mechanics at his time and could not use the full power of the theory as it has revealed since, which means that Einstein was still able to try to counter the arguments by Bohr, which is no longer the case today. So I think the argument between Bohr and Einstein is of different nature.
Professor Mirko Jakić.
Thank you. I have no doubt that this twin paradox is not a paradox at all, because it is a deductive consequence of the theory of relativity. But basically, the relation between philosophy and physics, I will just mention that in Plato, philosophy, his ideas are perfect and unchanging. Because in this world, of course, it's just a different situation, it's a speculative situation in Plato's philosophy, but it's just in perfect copy of world of ideas, because everything is changeable. It's just a copy for ideas, which is, of course, unrealizable in space and time. Time is not going on. So this is no relation between such an old picture of everything with modern physics. But I have one question. What is a photos? Photon of light,
yes.
And put in it one clock, what will we show? Time is zero.
Yeah.
Yeah, of course. As we can't put two things like Einstein told in his mental experiment, it is unreliable when this is only his mental experiment about the rotation of time, of length, and such a thing. But it is deductively convinced that it is no time
for
the photons. Time is not going on.
For
the photon.
Sure.
Yeah. Light is the similar situation is with Plato's. Plato's ideas. Well, this is just a little sketch between philosophy and thank you.
That's just a good point. Indeed, the very fact that time depends on the way you move in space-time, the ultimate statement is the one you just made for a photon which always go with a limit velocity, time does not pass. A photon is timeless, that's true. But photons, if they have zero mass, which is not quite certain, by the way, if particles with absolutely zero mass exist, they are timeless. That's true.
Nevin Bilic.
Thank you. I have a small comment concerning general relativity. You said that we need general relativity only if we include gravity. But in fact, general relativity is more complex. It includes also accelerating systems. In fact, accelerating systems are locally equivalent to gravitating systems. So you can repeat your calculations on twin paradox. In general relativity, you obtain the exactly the same accurate results. And moreover, I would say from the conceptual point of view, general relativity is simpler because all the systems, not only inertial systems, are equivalent in the sense that the theory is diffeomorphism invariant. So the twin paradox does not exist in general relativity. Whatever you do the calculations, you get exactly the same result in any reference frame. Thank you.
Yes, well, I perfectly agree with the fact that general relativity encompasses special relativity. But my point was the following. In order to understand or eliminate the twin paradox, you don't need to go to general relativity. General relativity, in some sense, is too general to tell you really what's going on. So first of all, and it, but you do not need it in that prime. So to appeal to general relativity is just a way to put the problem in another setting. Well, you can solve it in special relativity without problems, so that's the point. But of course, general relativity agrees with the same result.
Professor Rutscht.
Sorry, I know time passes, but I have just a small question in connection with the question of colleague Bilic. So, in the end of your talk, not in the conclusions, but just before the end, you said you talked about chronogeometry as a different kind of perspective to, let's say, to relativity, to space-time, and so on. And I've written your words down, not larger seconds, but there are more of them, let's say, between two events A and B. Well, does it mean, in philosophy of time, there was an old question, a classical question, how long is one second itself? At which pace the time itself, if there is something like time, flows? And would that mean, this point of view, that 1 second is actually 1 second? Because I didn't quite catch your point here. If you say there are more seconds, or if you say in the classical way, considering space-time, that the seconds are larger, what's actually the difference here from the physical point of view?
Well, look at it with the spatial analogy I tried to put forward. You would not use an expression like space is shorter or things of that sort when you compare a straight trajectory with a curved one, right? 1 meter is 1 meter. Use the same type of measurement device whether you are going in a straight line, whether you go according to a curved one, right? A meter is a meter.
Please use the microphone.
Sorry. I agree with you, but you are always inside some reference frame. You can just say that, as far as I can understand, the main point of relativity, you don't have an universal reference frame, an actual universal reference frame. And you're always in your own, let's say, reference frame, and from your reference frame, the second of in some other reference frame is larger.
I will also underline this question. I disagree with your statement that 1 meter is 1 meter. It's as far as I understand relativity, 1 meter is not the same for the different observers. And what you presented when you presented the trajectories of two, of Seb and Tracy, it was, you didn't present from the two points of view. Can we look back? Maybe, but if that's possible, I think this is going to be now a little bit a technical thing. I propose that we discuss it later, but I have to say that I disagree with the statement that 1 second is 1 second. It is completely different with respect to my understanding of theory of relativity and 1 meter. So I, if you want to, so it is at the beginning when you traced, when you presented the formula, small t1 and the big t1. And this is not, you presented it just in one reference system. You didn't do the calculation in the other reference system. That's a problem. So just the beginning, first time you present space-time diagram, and when you, yes, very, it's a tent or something like that. So can you go fast? So yes, for this, yes, okay. This, for instance, when you say, please present the formulas. Yes. Well, maybe it is, you don't have them now. Yes, now it disappeared.
No, I don't know where.
Yes, okay. Can you comment on this? This, and because you represented a horizontal line. This is the simultaneity in one reference system. But you have the lines of simultaneity in the other reference system. And
I have not said that T1 is equal to T2 or T1 equal big T1 equal to T2. Just this point is the point as seen by Seb when Tracy goes backwards. So what is the problem?
The problem is that you have the hyperbola of unit time, which depends what every reference system considers as a unit of time. And this is not, as you know, the second counted by B from the reference point of A is different. He says his second is not the same as mine.
Oh, sure, he says that, but he's wrong. Sure, that's Bergson's argument about the so-called perspective effect. As I may repeat, the clocks of Seb and Tracy are the same, and for each of them, what's going on is going on at the same rate. I have not spoken at all of Tracy as seen by Seb or Seb as seen by Tracy. I don't care about that. I'm just comparing what is going on for Seb or for Tracy. You can, of course, make calculation to see whenever Seb will look at Tracy or Tracy look at Seb and so on and so on. But you don't need that. That's just a complication which is not needed.
So small T1 and capital T1 are in different reference frames. But when you related them, the formula which is missing now, but I think this is a technical thing, we can discuss it later. Are there some other, are there some other questions which we have to, okay, then I think we thank you once more, thank you very much, and we'll pass. So we will not conform to the schedule which was presented. We will continue immediately with the next lecture, and we will have the coffee break after this lecture. So I call Professor Tomislav Živković from Institute Ruđer Bošković for his talk. Now we will pass to even more complicated things, to quantum mechanics, notions of space and time. So please.